So Stefan Molyneux yesterday made a video titled YouTube Almost Banned Me and went on a 10-minute long explanation of his experiences being on the road with Lauren Southern and being shut down at events. Later, after he got home, he was given 2 strikes on his YouTube accounts, which were later reversed. And then he closes the video off with a plea for more money. Now, there's plenty of videos explaining why him asking for money is absurd and shitty. And I'll link to one of those in the description. But this video is not about that. This video is about how if Stefan Molyneux does lose his YouTube channel, I won't feel bad for him. And in fact, I would feel that some justice was served. Let me explain. So in late 2014, an article, link in the description below to the mirror of this article, showed up on BuzzFeed. Yeah, I know. By an author named Polly Doyle, who was interviewing an anonymous whistleblower about Stefan Molyneux, who later outed herself as a woman named Colleen. She did a few other interviews, and I'll post links to those below, and as well as her YouTube channel, where she also talks about her experiences in what she describes as a cult. She talks about her experience in the quote-unquote inner circle, a term that she described a group that was the closest to Molyneux in Stefan Molyneux's group, called Friends of FDR. She describes her experiences as being very cultish, if not a cult, and some of the more hidden tenets of FDR, which is buried under hundreds of thousands of hours of content, which is really hard for people to find a lot of times. They usually get the really more rosy stuff, and then you find the more deeper, darker stuff later as you go along, as the onion gets peeled back. They also link to many videos by a YouTube critic of Molyneux named True Shibes, which I will be calling True Shibes from now on. It started making their rounds on social media, very, very, very big rounds. These videos that True Shibes was making contained audio and video clips of Molyneux's show juxtaposed with text commentary. It really showed the more crazy, bizarre, authoritarian, and cultish behavior of Molyneux. Very rarely did it have any content with people who called into Steph's show. And when it did, the focus was always on Molyneux and what he said, and it was always in full compliance with fair use. So I'll post a link to True Sheeb's channel in the description below. I highly recommend seeing some of her videos. They're really good. On August 17th, 2014, afterwards, True Shibe started getting her first wave of bogus and fraudulent DMCA claims against her channel. Later that day, a second wave, bringing her channel up to 2 strikes, and then the next day, the third wave hit and her channel was terminated. Also, a channel called Freedomain Damon was also hit in a similar fashion. A channel that went to the very gross and painstaking task of tracking down callers of Freedomain Radio's call-in show, finding their names and pictures and juxtaposing those pictures and names with the calls where the callers were describing very embarrassing facts about themselves to Stefan Molyneux. Very gross, by the way. In one of the videos, a young child was doxxed, who was a relative of one of the callers. I mean, it was absolutely disgusting. Though this channel was very, very, very small, and so were the view counts, and was relatively unknown, even in circles who were hostile to Stefan Molyneux. Of course, no one in True Shibe's video catalog had ever had any sort of thing like this at all. Like, no callers have ever been doxxed in True Shibe's videos. I even offered a challenge for someone to find one, and it has been well over 4 years, and no one has still provided a single example where any caller was doxxed on True Shibe's channel. Later, Michael DeMarco makes this post on FDR. The title reads, "Because people have asked, I've received messages from several listeners about their calls/images/videos from participation in our shows being used to bully them online. This was spread across 2 different channels, and they asked if I could have had the content removed. Going after listeners is completely unacceptable, and I used the methods at my disposal to remove the material. If you attack listeners, you don't get to use our material. That's the line." Shortly afterwards, Stefan Molyneux appeared on Joe Rogan's show and repeated the same lie.
But in that aren't a lot of these ideas. They're not, it's not, these aren't essentially black and white issues. And when you state them as if they are black and white issues, that's what opens up all these portals of debate and dissent. And there's just, there's quite a few places online where people are upset at you. And quite a few things that you have said in these hour-long eloquent pieces that people have vehemently opposed.
Yeah, and I'm annoyed that it's not more. Like,
really?
I want people.
But don't
who,
you try to stop them?
Stop them? No.
Don't you pull videos down? Don't you like pull videos for copyright infringement and tell people to not make videos?
Oh no, 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 no. Oh, this just recently happened. So yeah, this is a guy who worked at FDR. There was a troll out there who
FDR Free Domain Radio.
Sorry, Free Domain Radio.
Which is your organization.
Yeah. So there was a guy. I'm going to say troll is going to poison the well, right? There was a fellow out there. I think he's a man, a gentleman of trolley persuasion. And he, I do these call-in shows where people call and we talk about sort of philosophy and ideas and whatever, right? And he had gotten some of those calls, and through a means I don't pretend to understand, he had, you know, doxing where you start revealing people's personal information. Mm-hmm. He'd got pictures of their kids. He'd found out where they live. You know, he had just done stuff where he was...
So someone just called in and he got pictures of their kids?
What can I tell you?
Why
I
do
mean,
you do that?
Can I pretend to know why people do this? No.
When this person called in, but just to elaborate, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but were these people being threatening? Were they criticizing you in some sort of an...
Oh, no. I think we were just having a conversation about something.
So
and
why
then,
was he trying to get this information about their families?
Well, so let's say I called, someone named Bob called in.
Okay.
And then someone took that slice of our conversation and worked like crazy to try and find everything out about Bob and then published videos with pictures of Bob and, personal. So look, everybody uses my stuff and I don't care about it. And you can do a search on YouTube for my stuff and everybody who said, I'd really like to reuse your stuff, I'm like, hey, go for it, right? But we had a number of listeners who called in and said, listen, this guy's doing some pretty creepy stuff with my personal info here. I'm not comfortable with it. So we used that mechanism to take that down. It's got nothing to do with copyright or anything like that. I just felt that listeners were being acted against in a negative way, significantly negative way. So that's what we did. But it's nothing to do with copyright or anything like that. People use my stuff all the time.
That's incredibly bizarre. So was this a scare tactic to threaten people that were criticizing you? Was that?
No. It's a scare tactic to try and get people to not call into my show. Like, so we'll target people who try to call into your show, and then we will start trying to find out personal information about them and so on. And it's only one or two people, and it's only happened once, but that's why we did that. That's why Mike decided to do that thing on YouTube, which I fully agree with. I think it's a terrible use of time, and it's a negative thing to do. And so, no, but people, I mean, if I was interested in taking down people who use my stuff, then why on earth would there be so many of my videos reposted all over YouTube?
Later, BuzzFeed's article was removed from the site with no explanation given to anyone, including the author, Polly Doyle. Although we don't know why it was taken down, one can make some very educated guesses. Lots of people have been challenging Molyneux and his staff on this, and their comments were either deleted on his channel, people were blocked on Twitter, and some posts were removed, including my own, from his web forum. Polly Doyle asked to be on the show, who was the author of the BuzzFeed article, and he was skipped to the front of the line. Of course, that line leaded straight to the rejection pile. As with anybody else who offered to talk about the DMCAs. Now, True Shibes ended up taking this to court and settling out of court, to which Molyneux rescinded the DMCAs, restated her channel, and agreed to post this on his forum. Title, Public Statement. Free Domain Radio, FDR, is a philosophy podcast hosted by Stefan Molyneux. A number of independent contractors are hired to perform a variety of tasks related to the show. On August 17th and 18th of 2014, one of these independent contractors, Michael DeMarco, served a series of DMCA takedowns notices based on the claims of copyright infringement against a YouTube channel hosted by Jay Raven entitled True Shibes, which contained dozens of videos and photos with excerpts of original FDR material. Subsequent to its receipt of the takedown notices, YouTube disabled the True Shibes channel. Raven never submitted any DMCA counter notices to YouTube. These events resulted in a dispute between FDR and Raven, as well as online speculation that the True Shibes Shibe channels had been taken down due to doxing of FDR listeners. FDR has subsequently investigated the issue and has not found any instances of doxing on the True Shibes channel. In any event, to resolve this dispute and foster a broad range of discussion and debate regarding FDR's content and material, FDR has no objection to the True Shibes channel being reinstated to YouTube, although FDR does not endorse the commentary and opinions of Jay Raven that are expressed on the YouTube on the True Shibes channel. And comments, of course, were disabled. Now tell me, why does Molyneux think that he can deserve a platform on YouTube when he breaks a law, initiates the use of government force? Yes, the DMCA is a legal affidavit. It's a threat of government violence, not a private company policy. To silence people who are critical of him and lies about it for over a year and keeps her channel down for over a year until he's forced to reinstate her channel through the legal system. By the way, all of this stuff was reported in mainstream outlets. How come the Kiwi Press didn't mention this when they were interviewing Molyneux and trying to put him in the hot seat? Because they're fucking clowns. Now, Molyneux is not a fan of platforming anybody who is critical of him unless it's in a very controlled setting where he can pick and choose who he thinks he can win a debate with. Everyone else gets blocked. This guy has so many blocks that it makes Steve Shives blush. By the way, this isn't the first time a scandal hit about him going after critics. In 2008, he doxed a host of a forum for people who were banned from the FDR forum called Liberating Minds. His response was to dox him and his podcast, and eventually driving him to close the forum. Now, if Molyneux loses his channel, it would be a very long overdue karma and a bit of poetic justice. It's something that should have been done a while ago, as filing false and bogus DMCAs is supposed to result in the termination of your YouTube account. So please, stop pretending that Molyneux is an advocate of free speech. He talks a good game, but his history on this is pretty clear. He's not interested in debate that he thinks he can lose. He is not interested in people peeling back the layers of his onion to find the more damning parts of his philosophy. Things like saying that taking your kid to Sunday school is child abuse, and if your parents did that to you, you should disown them. Or how his whole show is quote-unquote bait on the hook to get kids and young people to come in and disown their family and their friends. And it's kind of odd that a person who has a YouTube channel less than 2,000 subscribers is the only person who's saying this right now, when there are mainstream articles talking about this instance. Come on, guys, get your shit together. You're supposed to be the news media, for fuck's sake. Yeah, anyways, hail Satan.